So good afternoon or good morning, everyone. So today is Katelin's third and last lecture on dark matter. But I'd like to remind all the students that there'll be the tutorial a little bit after the lecture. And so please all show up with your questions to the tutorial, because I think that's very important. So please take it away, Katelin.
Okay, sounds good. Go ahead and share my screen. All right. All right, so here we are, lecture three on dark matter. This is a continuation of the previous two lectures. So just to really quickly recap what we've talked about so far, we talked in lecture one about dark matter requirements. The thing that we can determine best about dark matter presently is its cosmological abundance, how much of it there is relative to the critical density. We know it can't be thermal and relativistic during BBN, otherwise the Hubble expansion is spoiled during that epoch. It can't free stream too much in the early universe because otherwise structure will get erased. It can't interact too much either with itself or with baryons. Otherwise, you mess up structure formation, you mess up the CMB, you can potentially mess up merging clusters. And we know that dark matter has to have a long lifetime such that it can be made at some point in the early universe and stick around to the present day. Okay, and so we talked about this whole range of possibilities for the dark matter mass. Really, it's a huge range of possibilities, 90 orders of magnitude. And yesterday, what we really focused in on is this sort of blue region, the WIMPs, because that is such a, dominant paradigm, or has been such a dominant paradigm for thinking about dark matter for such a long time, and for good reason, as we saw. So when we focus on this question of trying to explain the cosmological abundance, one of the simplest ways of getting the cosmological abundance is from this whole freeze-out story, which we talked about in detail yesterday. So just to quickly remind you, when you have freeze-out, if you plot the co-moving density of the dark matter as a function of time, or if you plot it as a function of temperature with temperature increasing to the left on this plot, then at very early times, the co-moving density is constant. Just that's because at very early times, dark matter, if its mass is much, much lighter than its temperature, it's relativistic. And so its number density scales like T cubed, which means that its co-moving number density is constant. So you have a flat part of the curve on the left. But as the temperature drops, temperature of the universe drops, then you transition into this other regime where the dark matter starts being non-relativistic. And at that point, if there are processes that are active that can deplete the number density of dark matter, then those processes will proceed in the forward direction. And so you'll basically start riding down this exponential part of the Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution, basically. Okay. So as long as these processes are active that can deplete dark matter, such as the one I've shown schematically in the bottom left corner, you will start being exponentially suppressed. However, that doesn't persist forever. At some point, these processes that are depleting your dark matter become very inefficient. First of all, because the universe is expanding, so these dark matter particles are having a harder and harder time finding each other in this expanding universe. Also, just simply because of the fact that the number density has dropped, right? So these dark matter particles have been so depleted by so many orders of magnitude that there just are hardly any particles left to engage in this kind of annihilation. Okay, so it's a combination of those two facts. The criteria is when n sigma v, the density, number density of particles, the physical one, not the co-moving one, physical number density times the cross section, thermally averaged cross section, when that is comparable to Hubble, is when you see a transition in the behavior between this exponential suppression and then basically going to a constant co-moving density once again. And as we saw yesterday, just using dimensional analysis, if you have a weak scale mass and a weak scale cross section, then you end up basically in the right ballpark to give the observed relic abundance of dark matter that we see basically in the present day universe, and that's consistent with what we observe in the CMB and other early universe type probes. Okay, so this is kind of a miracle. This is called the WIMP miracle. It didn't have to be this way. It didn't have to be the case that we put in known scales of physics into this whole thermal story, and out pops the amount of dark matter that we observe. Okay, so one thing I really want to stress about the situation is that for a thermal freeze-out, it's really independent of initial conditions. Okay, so if a coupling between dark matter and the standard model exists, like any coupling that's sufficient to thermalize the dark matter, then regardless of initial conditions, because of, you know, things are just going to come into a thermal equilibrium, regardless of whether you have no dark matter in, you know, in the very, very early universe, let's say if you have a theory like inflation, where you have some sort of reheating, you know, maybe you reheat some sectors and not the other sector, that's perfectly fine. If you have this thermal coupling, you will populate this dark matter. Conversely, if the dark matter is, you know, too abundant in the very, very early universe, like way before freeze out, again, it's going to come to some thermal equilibrium. It's going to heat up the standard model sector. Okay, so as long as dark matter is coupled sufficiently to the standard model to be in the bath, we really don't care about what's happening at early times. So this is a very nice predictive scenario. So that's very nice. As we talked about briefly yesterday, the scenario is fine with early universe observables. So that's another really nice feature of this kind of mechanism. And also, as we saw yesterday, the relevant couplings can be experimentally probed. It's always nice when you have, you know, some really tight correspondence between what's happening in the very, very early universe and something that you can probe today. And that's, I guess, a theme that you guys have probably been hearing about over the past several days. Right. So yesterday we briefly talked about indirect detection, which is, in my opinion, the most direct probe of thermal freeze out. OK, so you have this again, this dashed line. This is the right thermally averaged cross section to give you the amount of dark matter that we observe. OK, if sigma V is too big, so if it's above that line, then you don't make enough dark matter, because if sigma V is too big, you basically ride down this Boltzmann curve even farther. So you basically stay in equilibrium longer, which means your density is ultimately going to be suppressed relative to what we observe. So if you're above this line, you have too little dark matter, you ride the Boltzmann curve down too far. If you're below this line, you have too much dark matter because you don't ride the Boltzmann curve down far enough. Okay, so you have to be right on this line to give you the amount of dark matter that we observe. The low mass end of this line is constrained by indirect probes of dark matter annihilating standard model particles and either creating gamma rays that we can observe using, for example, the Fermi Gamma Ray Space Telescope, and pointing it at systems that we know are very dark matter dominated, like dwarf galaxies. Alternatively, there are some CMB probes of this type of a process. Because if you have dark matter that's annihilating into standard model particles in the early universe, you're injecting a lot of energy, and you can possibly mess up recombination, which is that nice story that we talked about in lecture one, which has been so good at telling us about the photon to baryon ratio. Okay, so you can potentially mess that up in an observable way. So that's the low mass end. And the high mass end, we also talked about briefly yesterday. This is this unitarity bound. It's simply the statement that you can't perturbatively make the dark matter with the correct relic abundance if the mass is too high, okay? Because of just how the cross section scales with mass, okay? We also have direct detection, but the way that you equate direct detection with what's happening in the early universe is highly model dependent. In particular, these processes that I'm depicting in the bottom left are typically dark matter scattering with some sort of atomic nucleus. And so because that's quite different from just pure dark matter annihilation in the early universe, you really get a range of predictions for different theories of freeze out in the early universe. So, you know, you may get discouraged if you don't find dark matter in one of these experiments, but it doesn't really say anything in a robust way about whether or not freeze out did or did not occur in the early universe. Okay, so there's really not a lot of robust conclusions that we can draw from a null detection of dark matter in these experiments. OK, Okay. But nevertheless, so the WIMP is great. You know, lots of smart people actively looking for that and searching for that. But increasingly, I would say over the past 10 years, it's been, you know, more and more urgent, I think, to go beyond the WIMP paradigm. Okay. Because since we're not finding the WIMP, I think a lot of people, you know, maybe worry that, you know, we don't want to put all of our eggs into one basket. In particular, the WIMP is just one example of a thermal scenario. And during this lecture, I'm going to tell you about other examples or ways that we can basically perturb the WIMP story or choose to make different sets of assumptions about what's happening in the early universe, which can perturb this story. Okay, so there's other thermal scenarios that can happen. And the WIMP miracle that we talked about could just be a coincidence of nature. You know, there's a precedent for this in the history of particle physics. For example, Rabi famously said, "Who ordered the muon?" Because when the muon was first discovered, it had a lot of the properties that Yukawa had predicted that pions should have. And so for a while, when the muon was discovered, people were calling it the mu meson, okay, because it had these really similar properties. But now, of course, we know that the muon is just a heavy electron. It's not related to the strong force at all. It just so happens that the mass scale of the muon coincides roughly with lambda QCD. So that's another example of a coincidence of nature where we were misled by numerology, essentially. So that's maybe indicating that that's not the best guiding principle. Okay. So other, you know, reasons to think about going beyond WIMPs. The WIMP story is extremely simplified. I mean, I know it took a whole lecture yesterday for me to tell you about it, but, you know, considering all of the assumptions and all of the simplifications that we made, the fact that you don't have to introduce any new forces, the fact that dark matter is one thing, and that, you know, you have no dependence on any initial conditions or anything like that, that's a very simple story. Which is great because it's predictive. But on the other hand, we know already that the standard model does not, you know, obey Occam's razor. The standard model is not the simplest thing that you could have possibly written down. And so, you know, it doesn't need to be the case that the dark matter is just one thing, right? It could be similar in terms of its rich structure and complexity in comparison to the standard model. So that's a very real possibility that I think is highly conceivable. And finally, you know, over the past decades and so on, we've gotten quite clever, developed lots of new technologies or thought of new kinds of observations that we can do. And, you know, a lot of those observations are going to unlock the ability to look at different kinds of models. So given that we're doing these observations, or that we have these capabilities, we want to make sure that we're, you know, we're not leaving anything on the table. We're really extracting as much information as we possibly can from these different observations and learning as much as we can about the universe. So, you know, given that fact, it really behooves us to try to think about what kinds of models make sense and can be tested by these observations. Okay. So, okay, so that's where my slides are going to end for the moment. And I'm going to now switch to the iPad. Okay, so let's see. Share my screen.
Maybe you wish to take a question or two?
Ah, sure thing. Is there a question at this point?
There is no question in the chat. Maybe we can ask the students. Do you have any questions? Raise your hand. Okay, there are none at this stage, Katelin. Please proceed.
Great. Okay, so yesterday we talked extensively about WIMPs, and part of that, you know, part of why I chose to do that was partly historical, just because, and not even historical, right, because this is still an ongoing search for these WIMPs. So that was part of my motivation, but also it was because I think the WIMP story is a really nice jumping off point, as, like I said, it's one of the most simplified things you can possibly do to explain the dark matter abundance in the early universe. So if we treat that as like the, you know, zeroth order case, so now we want to perturb around it. So now we want to revisit some of the assumptions that we made. So basically the next portion of my lecture is basically ways to break WIMP assumptions. Okay. So I'll just go through a few. So we assumed that sigma V was a constant. Okay, when we were doing the dimensional analysis to try to figure out what mass scales and what couplings would correspond to the relic cross section that we need, we assumed that velocity was not relevant. And so we were ignoring that in formulating the cross section. But it could have dependence. So it could have sigma V as a function of V. Okay. So, for example, if you have P wave dark matter, that's just the statement that sigma V scales like sigma V naught, so some normalization at some velocity scale, usually chosen to be the speed of light, times V squared. Okay, so in this case, this is still a WIMP. So this is actually still the WIMP picture. This actually basically breaks our ability to detect anything. So in the early universe, V is close to one, but in a galaxy, V is like 10 to the minus 3. So our ability to look for this with indirect detection is going to be suppressed by orders of magnitude. So indirect detection becomes nearly impossible. Just because the annihilation rates are so small because of the low velocity scale of galaxies and dwarf galaxies and so on. Okay, so that's one way that even if we go back to that indirect detection plane that I was showing you guys, even if we were to exclude all of that, all of those constraints only apply to the S wave case. That's the constant cross-section case. P wave would take leaps and bounds of improvement in terms of our sensitivity. So we do not currently foresee really having the capability of doing that. Okay, so that's one major loophole, I would say. So where you get to keep everything the same with the WIMP story, but just make it nearly undetectable. Okay, another point. What if the dark matter mass isn't the only mass scale? So yesterday we said, we just said that on dimensional analysis grounds, sigma V had to scale like alpha squared over M, let me call this M dark matter squared. Okay, but if dark matter is lighter than the mediator mass, then we know just from, again, like applying some knowledge of particle physics that this scaling that I wrote down up here cannot be the right scaling. In particular, if we have some mediator that's relatively heavy compared to all of the other scales in the problem, like the mass of the dark matter and the temperature, then we know that just from the propagator, there has to be a 1 over m mediator to the fourth power. Right, just from the propagator and in the matrix element, and then squaring that. Okay, but this doesn't have the right units, right? So sigma V has to have units of mass to the minus 2. This has units of mass to the minus 4. I'm going to keep my alpha squared, and to make it have the right units, I'm going to add an m dark matter squared upstairs. Okay, and that makes it have the right units. And in detail, if you actually compute cross sections in this regime, this is the scaling that you'll find, depth to order unity corrections, 8 pi's and so on like that. Okay, so just for explicitness, let me take this mediator to be the Z boson, okay? So if this is a literal weak scale process where I have dark matter annihilating through the Z boson to standard model, then that would apply. And so if we take, alpha of order 10 to the minus 2, which would be applicable for the electroweak sector, and if we use MZ is around 100 GeV, then sigma V is too small if M dark matter is less than 1 GeV. Okay, and if sigma V is too small, then again, going back to the plot that I showed you just now and that we talked about extensively yesterday, if sigma V is too small, you don't ride the Boltzmann curve down far enough. And so you overproduce dark matter. You can potentially overclose the universe. Obviously, that's a big problem. So if sigma V is too small, that's ruled out. And this is sometimes referred to as the Lee-Weinberg bound. Okay, and so this implies that thermal dark matter below 1 GeV must have another mediator. That's responsible for freeze out. Okay. And that's why you'll often hear this correspondence between sub GeV dark matter, and that kind of corresponds to dark sectors. Okay, so if you have freeze out of dark matter below a GeV, that can't be just a vanilla, you know, weak force, weak interaction freeze out. It has to be some new kind of force carrier, some new kind of mediator, which means that this dark matter is not just coming along, you know, on its own. It's bringing along this new mediator, this new force carrier for a ride. And so once you know about, you know, the necessity of having this kind of a mediator, then that also opens up a lot of possibilities for testing this dark sector simply by looking for the mediator. And so you can do that in a number of ways, including at colliders. That's one, you know, very robust and sensitive way of looking for these mediators. You can also look for them in astrophysical contexts, like for example, in supernovae. Okay, so that's a whole, you know, very rich rich area. But you know, there's so many ways we can perturb these assumptions we've made. So I have to move on just because there's so much to cover. Okay, so another assumption that we made. So yesterday, we assumed that whatever is depleting this dark matter is a 2-to-2 or 2-to-n process, okay, where this was a standard model stuff. But what if dark matter annihilation isn't 2-to-2? What if it's, you know, n to 2 or n to m? Okay, so one example. So what if it's, you know, what if it's not 2-to-2? So what about 3-to-2? If you think about this possibility, what about 3-to-2? You actually don't need to have standard model stuff in this final state. You could actually have both of these processes on both sides of this interaction be dark matter, because you still have a number changing process here. And if you just do the same kind of arguments that we talked about yesterday, but just with 3-to-2, and if you put in strong scale couplings and masses, then you get the right relic abundance. So that's kind of cool. That's called the simp miracle. Okay, so it's a lot like the wimp miracle that we talked about, except now instead of a weak interaction, we're talking about something happening at the scale of the strong interaction. And you know, it's miracle. So, you know, this is another miracle. Maybe you're only allowed to have one miracle. So maybe this is an indication that these miracles are not necessarily so miraculous. Maybe it's possible to get the right dark matter abundance using known scales of physics in a lot of different ways. You know, theorists were very creative. So maybe that's indicating that, yeah, maybe this numerology wasn't such a good guiding principle after all. Okay. One other piece of motivation for this is that we know already of examples of 3-2 interactions. So in the standard, model, pions undergo 3-2 processes. So there's a really good analogy to be made here with things that are already happening that are known in the strong sector. So we don't even really have to speculate about the possibility of this kind of interaction because we already know that it happens with standard model pions. In particular, it can happen generally. Excuse me. It can happen generally when you have chiral symmetry breaking in gauge theories that have the right kind of gauge group structure. You just have to have the right properties of the homotopy group of the coset space. It's not something I want to get into, but if you are interested, I can send a reference. But this basically gives rise to the very well-known Westermino-Witten action. Okay, so that's pretty interesting. And one thing that's pretty different about these other kinds of dark matter annihilations that have number changing processes is that by conservation of entropy, the final state gets a kick. So because, you know, we're changing from 3 dark matter particles to 2, you also have to conserve energy, I suppose. So because we're converting rest mass energy of one of these particles into some other form of energy, in this case, kinetic energy, we have to basically give these dark matter particles a kick in the final state. And so that means that in order to preserve structure formation, we need a heat sink. We need somewhere to put all of this extra energy. And we have the standard model, that could be a good heat sink. So this implies a portal to the dark sector. So we didn't need that portal to set the relic abundance because, you know, what was happening up here was purely dark matter interacting with dark matter. But coming back to what we talked about in lecture one, needing to preserve the successes of the theory of structure formation that we currently have, then we actually need to actually invoke a portal to the dark sector. Is there a question? I see something in the chat, but I'm not able to see what the question is.
Yes, I had a question.
Robert,
The expansion of the universe is not enough to dilute the velocity?
It's not, no. Mm-mm.
Is there an easy way to see that?
Because
we're talking about the radiation era.
Yeah, so this is happening, like, right, this is the same, you're still riding down the exponential Boltzmann, so it's the same kind of story as with WIMPs, just with a different interaction, but you're exponentially depleting this, you know, initial state. So your final state particles are really getting quite a big kick. So it's quite hard to dilute that. This is sometimes referred to as cannibal dark matter, and there are quite strong constraints on that. So you definitely need a heat sink for sure. Mm-hmm. If you want, I can provide some references later on. I don't have a quick way of showing it though. Yeah.
Thanks.
Mm-hmm. Cool. Okay. Other questions at this point? Anyway, yes. modulo this question, which again I can provide reference for, maybe in the Slack channel for the summer school or the winter school. Maybe I can provide some links as well. But you know what we're seeing is, you know, the consequences of the observational constraints from lecture one are implying the need for new particles to make this story self-consistent. So we need a portal into this dark sector to transfer entropy to the standard model. Again, just like the previous case where we have this, you know, dark sector up here, you can actually try to constrain this situation, not by necessarily looking for the dark matter itself, but also looking for the mediator. And that can set really interesting constraints. Okay, another possibility is you can have a co-annihilation. Or co-scattering of non-degenerate states. So maybe let me call my dark matter like this, and let me say I have some other particle, maybe psi, and maybe something's happening and they're going to stuff in the standard model. Okay, and by messing around with the relative masses or relative temperatures or abundances of these different particles, that can really give me a whole sort of menagerie of different kinds of phenomenology. Again, I can provide some references in the Slack channel or later on for those who are maybe interested. Okay. Other possibilities. What if sigma V has a strong or a resonant temperature behavior. Okay, so we already saw up here, talk about P wave dark matter, where we have this kind of velocity scaling. In general, for any velocity scaling, you can always decompose it, right? You can do a Taylor series in terms of the allowed velocity scalings that you have to have. So it always has to be an even number of powers of velocity, but you can in principle write down any sort of sigma V as, you know, sigma V naught plus sigma, you know, sigma V one V squared plus sigma V two V to the fourth and so on. But that Taylor series doesn't really work. If you have some really resonant or really sharply peaked behavior, that series is not gonna be so helpful. And so what that can actually do is you can actually really substantially lower the couplings between the dark matter and the standard model. In doing so, you can lower the couplings, but still get the same depletion of dark matter when you're in this resonant regime. And so that can make it so that it's, you know, you can evade a lot of constraints coming from direct detection or collider bounds. But again, to get this resonant T behavior, one sort of way that you can achieve that is by having the right properties of the mediator, where the mediator is perhaps going on shell. So again, that's telling you, again, you have to have some interesting mediator. So this implies an interesting mediator. And you can then try to constrain this theory of dark matter by looking for the mediator. Okay, here's another flavor of ways that we could change this story. What if dark matter chemical potential mu is not zero? Okay, so we assumed it was zero when we wrote down the various number densities of our dark matter in different regimes, but that doesn't necessarily have to be the case. And that is called asymmetric dark matter. So that's where you have more dark matter than anti-dark matter. And there are ways to basically tie the asymmetry in the dark matter sector to the asymmetry that we already know about in the standard model. So this could explain why it is that omega baryon and omega dark matter are the same up to factors of order unity, factor of five, right? So they're not very different from one another. And that is a little bit weird, just given, you know, what's happening in the early universe, with this whole thermal history, it doesn't necessarily seem a priori like this needs to be true. And so maybe you can suppose that there's some common origin for having a non-zero chemical potential, you know, for whatever was responsible for baryogenesis. Okay. So I'm not going to go into that because I don't have enough time. So much to cover today. Okay. Another possibility, what if the dark matter is not in chemical equilibrium, or excuse me, kinetic equilibrium? With the standard model. And, you know, what if maybe they're in chemical equilibrium but not kinetic, or what if they're not even in chemical equilibrium? Okay, so in particular, you know, in this second case, in the case of not being in chemical equilibrium or kinetic equilibrium, you could have an entire secluded dark sector. So a secluded dark sector, with its own thermal history, with its own temperature dark matter, which is not equal to temperature of standard model. And in particular, inside of this dark sector, you could have a dark matter only version of freeze out. So you could have, let me call it X. X goes to dark matter, oops, in its own sector, similar to the SIMP case. But you know, then later on, you could actually require, just like the SIMP case, that there has to be some portal. Okay, so this is really starting to, now that you start to set these things to different values, you're really opening up a Pandora's box. So this is you're opening a Pandora's box of possibilities, because now you have a lot of degrees of freedom. Is there a question in the chat?
Yes, could you remind me what chemical equilibrium is?
Basically just whether number changing processes are in equilibrium, or whether processes that exchange momentum between the two sectors are in equilibrium. So in many cases, one implies the other, but not necessarily. So you can always have certain interactions that, you know, you would think in the simplest models were keeping both kinds of equilibrium maintained, but in some theories, you can actually make some of those processes forbidden, such that you can have either chemical equilibrium or kinetic equilibrium. Okay. Thanks. So I'm not going to go into any detail on this, just because, like I said, it's a whole Pandora's box once you start, you know, making it so that these temperatures can be different. And I just wanted to mention this possibility. If you want some references, there are a ton of references on this point. I can send some in the Slack or later on during the tutorial. Okay. So this is a Pandora's box. Alternatively, this is a model builder's dream. Okay, I even know one model builder who, you know, has started looking into the possibility of multiple dark sectors, all with different temperatures, like all kind of cascading into another. Okay, so at that point, it can get really complicated. But, you know, it is possible. Like I said earlier on, the standard model is not, you know, not so simple to write down. Took us many decades to figure out exactly what was going on. So, you know, it's a possibility. We're kind of moving further and further away from perturbing further and further away from the WIMP case, which is the most predictive case. So I think that's reflected in just the fact that I don't have time to cover all of the ways that you can perturb and have not the same temperature. Okay, the last example I want to talk about is kind of the most extreme case that, you know, where the dark matter can have any sort of, maybe not thermal behavior, but any sort of contact with the standard model. So what if the dark matter isn't thermal in any sense? So not with the standard model or with itself, but has some contact, has some non-thermal level of contact. This case is actually called freeze-in. Okay. I actually have a few slides I want to share with you about freeze-in. This is something that I've worked on quite a bit, and I think it's really interesting because, I guess as I'll show you, in spite of the fact that the dark matter isn't thermal in any sense, neither with the standard model nor with itself, you would think that that would mean, because that implies a really weak coupling, that there would be really no way to test this, but there really are. So let me just, finish with this preamble and I'll show you some slides. Okay, so freeze-in is the weakest possible coupling. The dark matter and standard model can have. Basically, in order to be relevant. For the dark matter abundance. Okay. So the reason why this is called freeze in and not freeze out is because for freeze out, we have, some large thermal abundance of dark matter, which the density of dark matter starts quite high, and over time it's depleted. And freeze in is in some sense the opposite, because we don't have very much of this dark matter because it's not thermal. It doesn't have a thermal abundance. So the only way to make dark matter in this case is by basically taking a little bit of density out of the standard model. Okay, so it's in that sense, it's the time arrow is going this way, time. Okay, so it's the opposite of freeze out. That's why it's called freeze in. Okay, so now I'm gonna pause this and I'm gonna share some slides about freeze in before talking about completely non-thermal production. Okay, so I'm sharing my screen. Okay, so like I mentioned, freeze-in is something I've worked on a lot. It's near and dear to my heart. So just tell you about some really cool properties of freeze-in. Just to reiterate what I was saying just now, it's in some sense the opposite of freeze-out, right? So with freeze-out, you have a high thermal abundance initially, and then over time as the universe cools, that gets depleted by this Boltzmann suppression. But with freeze-in, it's really the opposite. You don't have, you don't start out with a high thermal number density. You can just assume that you start out with no dark matter, but because there's this very, very weak coupling between the dark matter and the standard model, you can slowly accumulate and build up a density of dark matter slowly over time. Okay, and you'll notice that in this plot, I'm plotting these densities at a dark matter mass of 1 MeV. We talked about this on Monday, the fact that this is actually kind of excluded because when you start with this very high thermal abundance of particles in the initial state, then freeze out is occurring roughly at the dark matter mass over 20. So in this case, it's roughly happening at 0.1 MeV. This dark matter sector starts off with quite a lot of entropy, right? Just the entropy that would be due to a thermal particle in the early universe. So it has a lot of entropy, which means that when it freezes out, you have to transfer that entropy somewhere, which means that you can potentially mess up the photon to neutrino temperature ratio in the early universe. Also during this epoch, the dark matter is mildly relativistic and its number density and energy density is non-negligible. So you can potentially also contribute to the Hubble parameter during this time, which is also not good from the point of view of Big Bang nucleosynthesis. So for this reason, as we talked about on Monday, there's, people often will say that you can't have thermal dark matter below an MeV. Okay, but as we see over here with freeze in, there's really very little entropy or energy in the dark sector initially, which means that as you slowly accumulate this dark matter over time, you're not appreciably changing any of the entropy in the Standard Model sector, and there's no contribution to Hubble. So that means that you can actually make MEV scale dark matter from freeze-in without messing up Big Bang nucleosynthesis. And so for that reason, freeze-in is, I would say, kind of a loophole, or one example of a loophole to the statement that you can't have thermal dark matter below an MEV. Of course, the dark matter is not thermal, but it's made from the thermal plasma of the Standard Model. So it's thermal-ish, okay? And as I just alluded to, you might think, okay, well, you know, going back to this picture, if you're making it such that the dark matter can't be thermal, that implies a really, really small value of the coupling between the dark matter and the Standard Model. Otherwise, if the coupling is too big, you're necessarily going to thermalize. So you might think, okay, this is never going to be detectable. Sorry, I just got a weird notification. Was there a question? All right. Zoom is just being weird for some reason. Okay. Well, anyway, so you might worry, okay, this is never going to be detectable. So, you know, why bother with this? But it's actually not the case. For example, if you have dark matter interacting with the Standard Model through a light mediator, okay, so if this coupling arises due to a light mediator, for example, like the Standard Model photon would be a good example of that, then, you know, indeed, even if the dark matter coupling to this photon is really, really tiny, so the dark matter would still largely be dark, even though it has a coupling to photons. But just because of the way that, you know, scattering happens via a light mediator, scales like velocity to the minus four, okay, just like Rutherford scattering. And that means that in low velocity situations, you can potentially get a really big enhancement to scattering kinds of interactions. Okay, so for example, in our galaxy, typical speed of dark matter is 10 to the minus three. So that's a really big enhancement for example, direct detection experiments. For that reason, freeze-in is really one of the key benchmarks. Like freeze-in via a light mediator is one of the key benchmarks for sub MEV dark matter direct detection. So in recent years, there's been a really big push to kind of go below direct detection experiments that we already have that are very good at the mass scales above a GEV, right? And the reason why those direct detection experiments that we already had built, why they're so good above a GEV is because of this Lee-Weinberg bound that we talked about. So because WIMPs had to be heavier than a GEV to be consistent, that was the design specification. But now that we're thinking more and more about these dark sectors and new kinds of mediators, there really has been a push to go sub GEV in terms of direct detection, or even sub MEV. Okay, and here are a couple of examples. These dashed curves on my plot here are a couple of examples of proposed direct detection experiments looking for sub MEV dark matter. Okay, as far as I know, these haven't been built yet, but they're all very promising because they're all relatively small scale experiments. You don't need a huge vat of liquid argon or liquid nitrogen or something. I guess nitrogen wouldn't work, but liquid xenon. You don't need a huge vat of stuff. This is more in the tabletop regime. So I think these experiments are quite promising. And freeze-in is a really one of the key benchmarks for these experiments because it is a loophole to the statement that you can't have thermal dark matter below an MEV. So it's kind of predictive in that sense, but it's also detectable at the same time. Okay, so what I'm showing you in this plot is the effective charge that you need between, the coupling between the dark matter and the photon to explain the abundance of dark matter. As you can see in this plot, this charge is extremely small, 10 to the minus 11 or so. So dark matter in this situation would still look dark from the point of view of what we can tell about it. Because this coupling is so tiny, but it would still be sufficient to explain where the dark matter of our universe actually came from. So that's pretty cool. So this is one way you can test these theories of freeze-in. Another really cool way that you can test them actually kind of comes back to the cosmology. Okay, so, was there a question about this plot?
Yes, I had a question. So why can the detectors be smaller? I would have naively assumed that you would need bigger detectors because the interaction rates are smaller. So somewhere I'm making a mistake.
Yeah, so a few things. So for fixed observed mass density of dark matter in our galaxy, the lighter you make the dark matter, the higher the number density. So there's actually a much bigger flux of these particles. So that's one factor. The other thing is that a lot of these kinds of experiments are actually using coherent effects. So it actually doesn't even make sense to necessarily talk about single particle scattering in this regime, because we're making use of collective effects, either at the level of the dark matter doing something in a collective way, or at the level of, a lot of the dashed lines over here are novel condensed matter systems that are gapped systems, where, collective excitations in these systems are kinematically very well matched to the dark matter that's incoming from just galactic with galactic kinematics. So those are kind of two of the reasons. But beyond that, you have to kind of go on a case-by-case basis to really see what the exposure has to be to give you a sufficient reach. Yeah. But yeah, those are just some heuristics that I can offer. Okay.
Thanks.
Yep. Other questions about this? Okay, so like I said, this is one great way of looking for this really kind of edge case of dark matter production where it's made from the thermal plasma, but it's not thermal. Again, this is really an extreme. This is an extreme case. This is the minimal amount of contact that you can meaningfully have between the standard model and the dark matter, such that there's any relevance to the abundance. So we talked about, this direct detection method, but you can also constrain the situation using cosmology. One, really powerful way of doing that is using the insight that the dark matter has to be born hot in some sense from freezing if it's being made at these mass scales. Because basically you're making the dark matter out of particles in the standard model. In particular, one of the key ways you're making dark matter is from E plus E minus annihilation or from this kind of funky collective effect that can happen inside of plasmas called plasmon decay. Basically, that's the decay of in-medium massive photons. So those are the two kind of main ways of making dark matter in this regime. And that's generally happening at a temperature corresponding to the mass of the electron. Just because, if you make dark matter from E plus E minus, E plus E minus is leaving the bath at a temperature corresponding to its mass. So if you, don't have any E plus E minus, then you can't make the dark matter from it. Relatedly, the plasma frequency or the plasma mass of this plasmon is related to the electron density. So you also have to do this before the electrons freeze out. And so if you're making sub MeV dark matter, what that necessarily implies is that the dark matter is a lot lighter than the temperature scale at which it's being made. So in a sense, the dark matter is born hot. It's not literally hot because, as I've mentioned, the dark matter does not thermalize, so it doesn't actually necessarily possess a temperature. So the way that you deal with that is you have to actually look at the full momentum distribution or phase space distribution. Okay, we talked about on Monday, it was yesterday, talked about Boltzmann equations. So normally you just want to solve the zeroth order Boltzmann equation to get the number density of dark matter. But in this case, you can't necessarily do that because the dark matter does not have a thermal distribution. You have to actually solve to all orders this Boltzmann equation of all of the moments, okay? So we did that in this work. And you find that the phase space distribution is the purple one, okay? It looks very, very different from the thermal distribution that you would expect for the same kind of energy in the sector. Okay, so it looks highly non-thermal, but nevertheless, one thing I want to draw your attention to is just the fact that I've plotted the momentum in units of the photon temperature. Both of these quantities scale the same way with redshift. So this is a redshift invariant quantity on the x-axis. And you can see that from birth, the dark matter momentum is or an order unity fraction of the standard model photon temperature. So that's telling you that indeed its initial conditions are that it's going relatively fast. Okay, so that should be kind of maybe ringing some bells from what we talked about on Monday, right? So if you have dark matter that's moving fast, then that's a little bit like warm dark matter. Okay, so we talked about yesterday how maybe warm dark matter is not necessarily the best theory in terms of, you know, you need to have an explanation for why you have all these degrees of freedom giving you the necessary temperature ratios. So this is, again, you know, my opinion is that warm dark matter should not necessarily be taken too literally, but it's still useful because you can map other theories of dark matter onto warm dark matter. And so that's what we did. We actually solved, the relevant Boltzmann equations, relevant clustering in the linear regime using some Boltzmann solvers, and can map Friesen phase space onto warm dark matter. And so that's one way that we can use existing bounds to set a constraint on this situation. Also, we can use this same picture that I talked about on Monday, where you have this photon baryon fluid and gravity is trying to pull things together, but radiation pressure is smearing everything out. If you have collisionless dark matter, then you have an advantage for gravity. You end up enhancing compression peaks. But if you can drag some of this dark matter out of the bottom of the potential well, then that can alter the acoustic properties of the peaks that you see in the CMB. In particular, for this case, the velocity information is very important because, as I was mentioning, the cross-section for scattering scales like velocity to the -4 for a late mediator. So you're really quite sensitive to, again, the full momentum space distribution of how fast is the dark matter going. So to determine To determine that, we again looked at the drag rate. So what is the rate of the change of velocity of these particles compared to the Hubble rate? And what we find is that it can be appreciable sort of at the percent level shortly before recombination. Okay, so that's telling you that that basically the CMB is probably going to be sensitive to it just because we can make percent level statements based on the CMB. Indeed, if you compute the changes to the acoustic peaks, so the delta CLs relative to what they are, you can see it's roughly a percent level change for Friesen. So we can actually constrain that. And with existing data, me and my collaborators actually analyzed some Planck 2018 likelihoods to look for this possibility. Altogether, all of these different probes that we talked about on Monday can all give really complementary constraints on this theory of dark matter, which are completely independent from any direct detection constraints and are all completely independent from each other. So all of these different systems making slightly different assumptions about systematics or observational biases, that's one thing that's really powerful about astrophysics and cosmology probes of dark matter, is that, you know, it's a very big universe that we have out there. So there's a lot of different lever arms that you have for testing the same theory. And you have to be consistent with all of them. And if one of them, you know, perhaps sometimes in astrophysics, you have, you know, big systematics or contaminants. So maybe if one of them is not as trustworthy, you have other probes that can really pick up the slack and really offer complementarity. So I think that's really, really nice. Okay, so with that, I'll stop sharing my slides and go back to drawing on my iPad. Because now I want to say, okay, that was the most extreme case where you could have any meaningful coupling, you know, between the standard model and the dark matter, and have that coupling be relevant to the abundance of dark matter. But the final frontier in this picture, we've started from the most thermal case, the WIMP, and we've gotten progressively weirder and weirder, perturbed further and further away from that. So the final frontier is that what if the dark matter is not thermal at all, and its abundance is not related to any thermal process. And a classic example of that is the axion. Okay, so just to give a quick overview on axions. So this is going to be the last portion of my lecture to talk about axions. So just to maybe talk a little bit about the history and what they are and why they're motivated. Axions are these particles that can address the following problem. So the standard model Lagrangian could have a term like, so Lagrangian standard model could have a term like alpha strong over 8 pi theta times GG dual, where this is some dimensionless parameter and these are the gluon field strengths and the dual. So this is the gluons. Okay. And in particular, this term violates CP, which we know is not a good symmetry of nature. It's not a, it's violated like in the weak sector. So this violates CP just like weak sector. Okay, but this term, excuse me, this term is gauge invariant. Okay, it's dimension 4. So it's not suppressed by high energy scales. Okay, and it's consistent with known symmetries. And in particular, I'm thinking of CPT. Oops. Okay. So from a bottom-up effective field theory perspective, right, where any term that can appear in nature should appear unless there's some symmetry protecting this, you know, or preventing this term from appearing. Unless that's the case, this term should appear in nature. Okay, but experiments say that this dimensionless parameter theta has to be, for the moment, less than 10 to the minus 10 or so. And so this is known as the strong CP problem. So why is it that this term, which is consistent with all the symmetries that we know about, why is this term not appearing? Okay. So there's a few solutions, but among sort of the best studied solutions, and one of the, well, as we'll see, it's also a popular dark matter candidate, but one of the solutions is to create a particle called an axion. So the axion solution is to make theta a dynamical field. Okay, so it's not a dimensionless number anymore, it's a dynamical field. And it's, so it's not a fixed parameter. And theta equals 0 corresponds to a minimum of potential. Such that theta is dynamically driven to 0. Oops. Okay. I believe it was Frank Wilczek who called this particle the axion, partly due to the fact that at the time, axion was a very famous brand of dish soap in the United States. I think it's gone out of business, or I haven't certainly seen it in my lifetime, but I guess the idea was that this axion sort of cleans up a lot of the problems with the standard model. Okay. So this axion, so now the Lagrangian, instead of looking like how it looks above, the Lagrangian instead looks like something that's proportional to A over some dimensionless parameter. I'm going to call that FA. And then I'm going to call this a decay constant in analogy to pions. Okay. And in order to solve the strong CP problem, we have to have this relationship between the mass of this axion and the decay constant. So we need to have MA FA being of order lambda QCD squared. So around 100 MeV squared. Okay. And that's just something that you can determine from dimensional analysis, right? We're trying to solve something, a problem happening at the strong scale. These are two dimensionful parameters. So in some way, their combination has to be related to the strong scale, okay? So in general, aside from solving this strong CP problem, axions can couple to other particles. Okay, so, and this is a somewhat model dependent statement, but a lot of these couplings can proceed through loops. So, you know, you can put some restrictions on the size of the coupling, but at some level you can't prevent the coupling, okay? So through loops. So for example, photons, electrons, et cetera. So there's model dependence, like I said. So for example, you can have something like Lagrangian with something like GA gamma gamma A times F dual, where this is the electromagnetic Faraday tensor. This GA gamma gamma, it depends on the model, how you equate that with FA, but you can do that in a model specific context. But in general, you can also just talk about axion-like particles which are any particles that has this kind of coupling. So anything with this interaction and it's not necessarily right over here, not necessarily related to strong CP. Okay. So this is how these axions interact. Now, a lot can be said about axions. I don't have a ton of time to do it. I think you could even have an entire lecture series about just axions, but I really want to focus on the dark matter angle and the requirements that we laid out in lecture one to be a good dark matter candidate. So let's just focus on that. So to be a good dark matter candidate, first of all, axions must be stable, right? So in general, the axions, if they have this kind of coupling, like up here, then they can decay. So axions can decay to two photons, and the lifetime you can show is like this. You could have gotten this from dimensional analysis. So this is a dimension five operator. So this coupling has to be dimension minus one. Lifetimes, so rates have to scale like the coupling squared. So the lifetime has to scale like one over the coupling squared. And since this is dimension minus one, this would have dimension two, but lifetimes have to have dimension minus one. So we have to stick an MA cubed down here. And then they have this 64 pi, which is not an order unity factor per se, but you can just get it from actually you know, solving for the, you know, doing the Feynman diagram and doing the phase-space integral correctly. And so recall that we want this to be much, much longer than the age of the universe. Okay. So if GA gamma gamma is on the order of alpha strong over 2 pi FA, and this would be true true for QCD axions, solving strong CP. If that's the case, then just plugging in numbers into this requirement means that the dark matter axions have to be much, much lighter than 25 eV to be dark matter. Otherwise, it's going to decay. Okay. So that seems initially like it could pose a problem, right? This 25 eV mass scale is a lot lighter than what we had talked about for warm dark matter, right? Where we were saying that the constraints on warm dark matter were more like a keV. And so anything lighter than that had to be excluded if it was going to be thermal. So the second point that we need to require is that because dark matter has to be, you know, cold by a certain time, we basically need to make sure that axions don't thermalize with the standard model. Because otherwise, if they do share temperature with the standard model, we're going to completely erase structure and we're not going to be here. Okay. So this is actually a case where not only is this is the axion a classic way to make dark matter non-thermally, but you actually need to require that it's non-thermal. Otherwise, you're going to mess up structure formation. So there's a lot of different processes that can thermalize axions with the standard model. One of the more relevant ones is via interactions with pions. So again, the criteria is we want H to be greater than N sigma V for this interaction with pions so that this thing is never coming into equilibrium. And we want this to be true at the QCD epoch. Okay, so that's when T is of order lambda QCD. And the reason why is because this epoch is the earliest time when it really makes sense to talk about interactions with pions. So you can't really talk about pions above the QCD phase transition. And because of how the temperature scaling works out for these interactions, you want to talk about the earliest possible times. That's going to give you the strongest interactions. Okay, so we have N sigma V. This is something that scales like T cubed for something that's thermal. Okay, scales like FA to the minus 2. And so this is going to scale like T cubed over FA squared. We want this to be bigger than Hubble, or excuse me, less than Hubble. So we want it to be less than T squared over M Planck. So that implies that we need FA to be less than or equal to square root of M Planck times lambda QCD. So this implies that we need MA to be less than around 10 to the minus 3 EV. Otherwise, it will thermalize. Okay. So now this is really pushing us into a really qualitatively different regime. Again, going back to my, you know, orders of magnitude of dark matter, we're now entering this regime where dark matter is being, you know, described by a classical wave. Okay, so If axions don't thermalize, where do they come from? Okay, so like I said, we're in this regime where you have a you know, very high occupation number. You know, it doesn't necessarily make sense to talk about individual particles. It makes more sense to talk about a classical field. Okay, so that's where the misalignment mechanism comes in. Okay, so let me say that the classical expectation value for this field, let me call that theta. Okay, so that's my expectation value of A, and this is a dynamical field, so I'm going to make it time dependent. Now this is the axion, again, not the scale factor. And this can get confusing in this business. Okay, so this is the axion field. And as we know, as you've probably seen several times through these lectures, the equations of motion for a scalar field, axions are a pseudoscalar, so they have these equations of motion. They look something like this. Okay, and so in general, if I have, you know, some field, right, it's got some funky shape. This is in field space. Okay, I'm just going to do a Taylor expansion, and I'm just going to look at what's happening for the lowest order piece of this potential. So I'm going to set V of theta approximately equal to 1/2 times the effective axion mass times squared times theta squared. Okay, and I'm going to ask about the temperature, or excuse me, the energy density of this field, because that's ultimately what I'm trying to get. I'm trying to get the abundance of dark matter. So that's 1/2 theta dot squared plus 1/2 ma squared theta squared. Okay, so that's what I'm trying to solve for. Now, in general, for some potential, this is gonna have, again, two qualitative regimes. So two regimes. First one is where the effective axion mass is much, much less than Hubble. So in that case, we ignore the potential. So we just have theta double dot, it's 3h theta dot equals zero. So that implies one of the solutions of this differential equation is that theta is equal to a constant. So in other words, Hubble friction prevents any motion. Sorry, was there a question?
Yeah, there was a question. Deep, can you unmute yourself?
Deep, can you raise your hand?
No, it's so maybe I can read the question. So FA should be greater than the expression as the condition goes.
Yes. I agree. Good catch. Yep. Because if we're putting an upper, yeah, right. If we're putting a, because FA and MA have an inverse relationship, if we're bounding MA from above, then we have to be bounding FA from below. That's absolutely correct. Okay. Good catch. Good. Okay. Anyway, so back to what I was just saying. So in this regime where your Hubble friction is really damping any motion, theta equals constant is a solution. So that means that you're going to have a constant energy density. Okay, because the kinetic term is a constant, or it's zero, and then this is just whatever the initial value is. Okay. Okay, second regime is a little bit more complicated. MA much, much bigger than Hubble. Okay, so now the axion field is going to start to oscillate with a frequency given by MA. But MA is actually a function of time or temperature. because of a number of background effects. Okay, so it's not quite as simple as if the mass were constant. So the way that you can solve for this is by writing down this ansatz, where theta is equal to theta naught times cosine ma of t, ma times t, so it's oscillating. But now I'm gonna give these oscillations an envelope. I'm gonna call that f of t. I'm gonna specify that this is some function which is varying slowly. So there's a separation of time scales. This function is not interfering with oscillations on a you know, per oscillation basis. It's just something that's happening on much longer time scales. So I'm going to say that TF dot is much, much less than F. So I'm going to leave it as an exercise because I'm running out of time. So as an exercise, you can show that if you plug this into the equations of motion, the EOM, and you find that F of T scales like A to the minus 3/2. Okay, and again, this is the scale factor, not the axion. To specify every time because it's confusing. Okay, so, and then what that implies then is that when you then solve for the density scales like A to the minus 3. And the way that you get this is by, yeah, you plug in this ansatz into the equations of motion and put in this assumption that this envelope is varying slowly. So that's how you get this. And then similarly, you get this the same way by basically dropping higher order terms. That's the easiest way to show it in this sort of limit. It turns out that in general, this kind of scaling behavior is an invariant, an adiabatic invariant of the equations of motion. And I'm not going to show that today, but if people are curious, I can provide some references. Okay. Is it a raised hand?
Katelin, I have a question, and there is another question as well. Are you assuming during this domain that the axion dominates the expansion?
No, not necessarily. No.
Okay. So, Neil, unmute and ask the question.
Yeah, hello. I had a confusion about mass less than Hubble limit. So if we conclude that theta is constant here, then if we substitute this back in the equation of motion, so we have this theta dot and theta double dot terms going to zero, right? And then it seems like it's not consistent with ignoring the potential.
Sure. So, sorry, you're just saying that if theta is a constant, then in the equations of motion, I have this term up here?
Yes. So then,
so it's not. I can't quite hear what the last thing that you said, but it's not literally constant. It's just approximately constant. So it's trying to roll down into the potential, but Hubble friction is sort of preventing it from moving appreciably. So the energy density is not exactly constant. It's just approximately constant.
Right. So both the theta dot and potential terms are small, but the potential term is still much smaller than the friction term, right? That's how you can neglect it.
I can't quite hear what you're saying. Maybe we can talk about this during the tutorial because I only have 5 minutes left and I wanted to talk about some other aspects of axions. So maybe you can ask me about this in the tutorial, okay?
Yes.
So there's another hand. Can it wait or to the tutorial or no?
Yeah, Robert has pulled down his hand, so we can, I guess we can discuss it in the tutorial. Please go ahead.
Okay, great. Okay, just wanted to wrap up. So, right, as an exercise, you can show that rho scales like A to the minus 3. This is easy to show in this limit, but you can show it's generally like an adiabatic invariant of the equations of motion. And so this implies that axions in this regime have the right scaling with redshift to be dark matter. Okay, so I guess maybe I should say cold dark matter. So it's not that you think about individual particles that are slow moving and that their particle number density is being diluted by expansion. It's more to do with the behavior of the axion as it's oscillating in this classical field context, okay? So in this case, then the relic abundance is going to be set by a combination of MA and theta naught. Okay, so recall that theta is the expectation value of the axion field, and we can then define theta naught over FA as being some dimensionless thing. We're going to call this the misalignment angle. Okay, and if the onset of the oscillation happens near the QCD phase transition, near lambda QCD, or I guess T being like lambda QCD, then, and that's, by the way, something we would expect because after lambda QCD, then that has a really strong effect on the axion's effective mass. So the criteria of having the effective mass being bigger than Hubble is easier to satisfy around this at around this epoch. So if this is when this oscillation starts happening, then for the QCD axion, we need MA to be of order theta naught over FA squared times 10 to the minus 5 EV. Okay, so this, again, this is this misalignment angle. It's dimensionless and it's expected to be order unity. Although there are certainly models or situations where you can have that not being true. But if it's true that this is order unity, then that predicts that this axion mass to be the dark matter should be in the ballpark of 10 to the minus 5 EV for the QCD axion. Okay, and this is in the right ballpark, so it's in the right ballpark to satisfy thermalization and stability criteria. So in other words, you know, we were led into this non-thermal production mechanism because we appear, we were requiring that the axion be stable and that it's not going to thermalize with, for example, pions. So you have to be pushed down into this low mass regime. And this misalignment mechanism gives us an axion mass that is consistent with that entire story. So everything sort of hangs together. In, I guess, maybe a couple, just final quick minutes, I can say a few words about how to look for axion dark matter. It's a really exploding research area, I would say, particularly in the past. Oops, I have to stop my other screen share, sorry. In the past 5 to 10 years, you know, people have been really thinking about a lot of new creative ideas of looking for axions. A lot of them make use of the coupling between the axion and photons. So the fact that you have this AFF dual term in the Lagrangian means that you can actually potentially convert axions to photons and vice versa. So here is an example of some constraints that come from that kind of coupling. The y-axis is this GA gamma gamma, and the x-axis is the axion mass. This plot came from the PDG, so if you want to look at the PDG and look in detail at where all of these individual constraints come from, you can feel free to take a look. But the ones in green in particular, which are starting to probe the QCD axion, Those generically are these so-called haloscope type of experiments, where you set up a resonant cavity that is resonantly tuned to the axion mass. You can leverage the coupling between the axion and electromagnetic fields. So if you set up a very strong B field inside of these cavities, you can potentially convert an axion to a photon. And if it's matched with the properties of the resonant cavity, so if there's a resonance, you can really have exquisite sensitivity. So that's one example, but there's a whole broader range of other kinds of ways, looking at modifications to Maxwell's equations from the presence of this sort of classical background of the axion field in our galaxy. You know, you can look for astrophysical environments where you have very strong magnetic fields, and axions and photons can interconvert, potentially giving you radio spectral lines or funny, you know, other kinds of effects from this conversion. It's a really rich area, really exploding in terms of ways that we can probe this parameter space. And so I think this is something that I'm really excited about. And I guess I'm out of time now. So I maybe just want to leave you on an optimistic note. So we started, you know, in terms of asking what are all the requirements that dark matter needs to satisfy. It seemed like there were relatively few requirements, but, you know, just by making some simple arguments and then satisfying those requirements, that leads us into a number of directions which have really interesting sort of behavior and implications, which you can then turn around and go back and test in some of the same astrophysical systems where we see evidence for this dark matter in the first place. It's a really, this is a really fun area to work on, because it's, you know, really rapidly evolving, and you can really see cycles of the scientific method unfolding in real time. So that's very exciting. And yeah, I'd be happy to take any more questions at the tutorial. So thank you all for your attention.
Thank you. Thank you, Katelin. So maybe we can break right away and then meet at the tutorial. That'll be fine with you.
Sounds good.
If there is a brief question, maybe we can take. Is there any brief question, students, which you would like to ask? Okay, I can't see any. Maybe we'll just take a break for 30 minutes and meet in 30 minutes for the tutorial.
Yeah, sounds good.
Thank you. Thank you, Katelin. We'll see you in 30 minutes, everyone.